In this session, we're going to be talking about visionary leaders. By way of introduction, I wanted to tell you that I think that vision and visionary leaders are one of the most important aspects of pastoral leadership. And I personally think a lot about vision, and I'm very much motivated by visionary thinkers. And I hope that excitement is expressed in what I say today. But by way of introduction, I want to read Proverbs 29, verse 18. Where there is no vision, that is biblical revelation, the people are unrestrained, but happy is he who keeps the law. So let me begin by saying that we must make certain that that vision comes from biblical revelation, and that the vision we have for our ministry and where we believe God wants to take us into the future is based on the Bible and not just our own creative thinking. Now, let me say this about vision, and this is a repeat. A vision is one of the most important elements of the ministry. It seizes us. It motivates us. It focuses for us. And by that, I'm saying that vision sets the path on which we as a church should be headed. And vision focuses us. That is, it keeps us on the path. So let me repeat that. Vision is one of the most important elements of ministry. It seizes us. It motivates us. And I'm talking about leaders now are seized by the vision that they believe that God has given them. And they are motivated by it, and it becomes the driving force in their life. And it focuses for the leader so that he or she understands the path that God has set. And then it focuses the leader in that it keeps the leader on the path. And I say that vision is valuable. It must be nurtured and it must be cared for. It doesn't just happen, but it needs to be treated as something that's very, very important and very, very tender. And what I call the essential aspects of vision, the definition, a four-point definition. First of all, the belief or conviction that a person is where God wants them to be. In other words, I didn't choose to be in this position. The Spirit of God led me to this position. And a pastoral leader needs to understand that and accept that and believe that. Secondly, vision is the ability to see what God wants to get done in that church's ministry. And by that, I'm saying then that the Spirit of God gives insight. Not only does he lead, but he gives insight into where he wants the church to head and what he wants to see the church accomplish. Thirdly, the ability to do what God wants done. And here I'm saying that this isn't done under our own power, our own abilities, but we're depending on the Spirit of God to empower people to accomplish his work in his church. And fourthly, the willingness to admit one's human frailties and depend on God. And by that I'm saying that no matter who the leader is, he or she will have imperfections, they will make mistakes, they need to admit those mistakes, they need to confess those mistakes, they need to say, God, I need to depend on you to make me a better leader and make me a better leader in this area. So in that sense, then, the Spirit of God is making his leaders willing to follow the vision that he sets down for them. So let me say this. It's very important that I say this. It's very important that you understand it then as we talk about vision. Vision is of the Spirit of God. It is not just our creativity, and it is not just our hard work, even though I will talk about the hard work of vision. But vision is of the Spirit of God. He leads us into it. He gives us the power to accomplish it. He gives us the insights of what he wants accomplished. And vision relates to faith. Romans chapter 1, verse 17, the righteous shall live by faith. In pastoral ministry, we're doing the work of righteousness, so that has to be carried out in faith. Romans chapter 14, verse 23, that which is not of faith is sin. So let me just be hypothetical here. Let's suppose that you and I are a church and I'm your pastor. If I'm just relying on my own abilities, my own leadership abilities, my own ability to see into the future, then I'm not living by faith And the Bible says, the Apostle Paul says in Romans, that then is sin because it does not bring any glory to God Almighty. In Mark chapter 5, verses 38 and 39, Jesus is getting ready to heal a child. And he says the child is just asleep, he's not dead. And he brings the child back to life. He manifested faith. In Exodus chapter 14, as we think about the Red Sea, we're thinking about faith again. In James chapter 1, verse 5, James tells us, if we ask for wisdom, God will give it to us. In other words, it's all right not to have wisdom. It's all right to need God to give us wisdom, but we have to believe God in faith and by faith for that wisdom. Now then, let me say this, that faith and vision go hand in hand, and they're developed like a muscle, and they grow when they're exercised. And then, this is very important, there is the spiritual gift of faith. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9, the Apostle Paul writes about the gift of faith. Now, moving forward, this is very important. Moving in faith to fulfill the vision that God gives us. And remember again, I want to underline that point. The vision that God gives us, we have to work hard and we have to work diligently. We have to believe God for the results. Zechariah chapter 4, verse 6, God says, it's not by power nor might, but by my spirit, says the Lord. And so we see the situation and we see the future with God's eyes, not our own eyes. So let me repeat that last point, that how do we move in faith and how do we move in vision? We do it by working hard. We do it by working diligently, by being smart, by saying no to good ministries that people bring to us that would take us away from the vision that God has set for us. We believe God for the results, and we see the future through God's eyes. Of your page, I have Hebrews 1. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, evidence of things not seen. In other words, in our mind's eye, we can see the accomplished fact before us. I think I told you when I first became a pastor, when I graduated from seminary and went to the first church I pastored, the very first Sunday, the church building was half full. And it had been that way for a number of years. And before I started my sermon, I told the people, I want you to turn around and look because God is going to fill this building. And some people actually laughed at me. But within about 5 months, I had the people, before I started my sermon, turn around and look because there were people sitting on the back rows, both sides of the building, and God was doing something. I was able to see the accomplished fact because God had given that vision and God wanted to do something special in that church. Now then, moving forward, the visionary leader. Let me encourage you. I want to encourage you to think very closely as I present this. Think very honestly and think very diligently. Is this who you are? And it's not wrong to say no. It's not wrong to say no, that is not who I am. Just this week, I was talking to a friend of mine. I met him in ministry. Both of us had graduated from university. We met in student ministry and we have been friends and ministered together over the years since then. As I was talking to him, he said, I am less a visionary leader. I am much more a one-on-one leader. And as I view his ministry, he is a man with a great heart. He's a man with a great caring heart. He's motivated by helping people in one-on-one situations. He's motivated by finding somebody who knows how to give care. And then he will put a group of people together where that person can lead those people who are hurting. For example, he put together in his church a group for women who had been sexually abused by their fathers. Obviously, he couldn't lead that group. It was a group for women. But he found the person who could lead the group. Then he advertised the group and people came there for help. But that was all motivated by his ability to care for people, to see people one-on-one, to meet them one-on-one, and then to touch their lives or have their lives touched, Does he have a great vision? No, but he has a great vision for one-on-one, touching people one-on-one. So this is why I say, think closely. Is this who you are? And it's not wrong to say, no, this is not how God built me. First of all, as we think about vision, we have to think about the word enthusiasm. It comes from two Greek words, entheos, in God or filled with God. So I suggest to you that vision is being enthusiastic or being in God or being filled with God. So we know what enthusiasm is. It's an excitement. It's an energy about getting something accomplished. And the person who's a visionary leader is enthusiastic about the big picture of what God wants to accomplish. On the other hand, my friend about whom I just told you is enthusiastic about touching people one-on-one, touching people in small groups. Secondly, the visionary leader has the ability to communicate the vision. Not only does he or she see what God wants to accomplish, but they have the ability to describe and communicate the vision. And that's a very important part of being a visionary leader. So as you think about what I'm saying in this session, think about whether or not you have the ability to communicate the vision to a number of people.
Even a small contribution can make a big difference. Jesus fed 5,000 people because of a little boy's 5 loaves. Regardless of the amount, your contribution is very important and greatly appreciated. Visit us at TVSEMINARY.com.
The visionary leader knows why and knows how God has blessed this ministry and will keep moving in that direction. The visionary leader knows the spiritual or human forces that work against the ministry. I know a pastor who was very, very successful, but he told me there was a man in his church who was had a strong need to be in control. He was a church boss, as we say in the United States. He was a church bully. He was not interested in growth. He was not interested in people coming to faith in Christ. He was not interested in people growing in their faith. He was interested in being in control. And therefore, the pastor needed to realize that this was a man that he needed to move out of leadership because he had this need to control, was not interested in ministry results. He was interested in control. I've talked to a number of recovering drug addicts and alcoholics who talk about the phrase addict logic. I'd never heard that phrase before, addict logic. And I said, what does it mean? And a recovering drug addict said to me, it means that I will think anything, I will say anything, I will do anything to get my next fix of drugs. I will say anything, I will do anything, I will think anything to get my next high. And I said, that's not logical. And the person said to me, of course, that's because you are normal. I'm an addict, and that's addict logic. I will twist the truth in order to get my next fix. Well, as I thought about that and applied it to different church bosses that I've known, and I realized this person about whom I'm talking then is like an addict, except his addiction is to control. Not interested in results, not interested in the church growing, only interested in being in control of every situation in the church. So I'm suggesting to you that the visionary leader knows the human and the spiritual resources that work against the ministry. The visionary leader then knows how to motivate people to join the ministry. He or she mobilizes them to be involved, and he organizes them for stability. You will hear those words a number of times in this session and the next session. Motivate, mobilize, stabilize. Motivate, mobilize, organize. Visionary leaders know how to motivate people to join them. They know how to mobilize them to be involved. And they know how to organize them for stability. Because if a vision is going to be carried out, people need to be mobilized and motivated to be moving in the same direction. Now then, the very important question, and that is, how do we get the vision from God Almighty? How does he speak to us? And I would suggest to you that he speaks to us in one of four ways. First of all, he speaks to our minds directly. Usually he speaks to the mind of the pastor or the leader. And I will talk more about that later on. Secondly, he uses our creative minds. We come together to talk about vision. We come together to talk about planning. And together we have a sense of what God is saying to us. He gives the idea to someone. Someone expresses the idea. And we talk about it. We refine it to make certain that it really is of God. Thirdly, we talk to and we observe other ministries. And I think this is very important for growing churches. I think this is very important for young pastors to have someone to whom we can talk, to have other ministries that we can observe, to see what they're doing, to see if they are doing something that we're not doing, but we could bring to our ministry that would help our ministry. And then fourthly, creative teamwork. We come together, we work together. No one has a stronger voice than anyone else. We're just working together to hear God's mind. So four ways that God speaks his vision to us. He speaks to the mind of the leader. We use our creative minds, oftentimes singularly. In observing and talking to other ministries. And then fourth, creative teamwork. Now, as you follow along in your notes, I ask a very important question. And again, this is for those of you who are thinking that maybe God has given you the gift of faith and that you're going to be a visionary leader, but also for those of you who are not certain. So, a very important question. Is vision a spiritual gift? Is it a natural tendency? Is it a biblical motivation? Is it an energy level? And the answer is yes, on all four accounts. Vision is a spiritual gift. Vision of faith, I call the same gift. Is it a natural tendency? Yes. Leaders are leaders, not only in the church, but other places. Is it a biblical motivation? Yes, because the visionary leader in the church understands what the Bible says he wants the church to accomplish, and he moves towards that. And then it's an energy level. And by that, I'm saying back to the word enthusiasm in God, filled with God. The visionary leader does not come to the church and say, I am so excited about our future. I want to tell you what God said to me. Well, who's going to follow that kind of a person? Rather, there's an energy level. The person is energetic, is enthusiastic, because what he wants to accomplish comes from God. Now, I'm going to talk more about this later, but evaluating our vision for our ministry. Some personal questions. What does God want to do with your life? It's very important that we understand that. What do you want God to do with your life? Are you willing to pay the price for what God wants to do with you? And by that, I'm suggesting there's always a price to pay, because it takes energy and it takes time to accomplish what God wants us to do. And fourth, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. Consider this. We'll talk more about it in a bit. Now to him who is able to do abundantly more than we can ask or think. Same questions for your church. Why did God create your church? Why did he plant it where he planted it? What does God want to do in your church? Do you know? Thirdly, what price are you willing to pay to see God work in your church? At one point when our children were younger, my wife and I and our two children went on a holiday. It was our 25th anniversary. And I said to our son and our daughter, you're old enough now, you're both university students, that I can ask you this question. What was it like being the children of a pastor? And they said, Dad, every Saturday afternoon, we watched your mind disappear. Your body was in our home, but your mind was gone because you were already thinking about the sermons on Sunday. So the price that I was willing to pay is that I realized that there was a sacrifice for my family because I was leaving them mentally in order to be prepared for Sunday. And then Ephesians 3:20 again, consider the verse, to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly beyond all that we can ask or think. How does that verse relate to your church's ministry?